I'm Julie Goodnight for another Daily Dose of Horsemanship Homework. And today's lesson is about the footfalls of your horse's gait and how to ride in rhythm. We're going to start right off with the walk. So the walk is a four-beat gait, and that means that all 4 feet hit the ground at a different time. It has no suspension. Suspension occurs when all of the horse's feet come off the ground at the same time, as they do in both the trot and canter. But the walk is a four-beat gait, so each of her 4 feet are hitting the ground at a different time. There's no suspension, so there's no upward lift in the back of the horse. And the walk is what's called a lateral gait. Lateral means side. And so the reason why we call the walk a lateral gait is because the feet on the same side move together. In other words, the footfalls of the walk are right hind, right fore, left hind, left fore, right, left, right, left, left. And so that's the walk. It's a very lateral gait. And so the rhythm of the gait is, it has both a 4-beat and a 2-beat rhythm. And so it can move my body in a very lateral way. So you feel the right, left in your lower body. Don't want that movement to come into your upper body at all. But as I ride directly away from you, and then directly towards you, you'll see that there's a lateral or side-to-side movement in my hips and legs, and that lateral or side-to-side movement is originating from her legs and her hips. And so when she pushes off with the right hind, her right hip lifts and my right hip lifts. When she pushes off with the right hind, the right side of her back muscles contract and I feel a lift in my right hip. Conversely, when she swings that right leg up underneath her belly, her hip drops and my hip drops. And as she swings that leg up under her belly, these back muscles underneath me stretch out and lengthen. And so again, my hip drops as her back and hip drops. So the rhythm of the walk is felt very easily in the seat and legs of the rider. The right, left, or lateral motion that you feel should only occur below your belly button and never above that. So I don't want that right-left rhythm to come into my shoulders and arms. So I'm not riding like this. I'm just moving my lower body in rhythm with the horse's body. So that's the walk. The trot. I'm going to have to go around you, I think. The trot is a 2-beat diagonal gait with suspension. So remember, suspension means that there's a moment in the stride when all 4 of the horse's feet come off the ground. So there is vertical lift in the horse's back. And the trot is similar to our jog or run, where there's a moment between the footfalls when we're completely off the ground. And so the trot has vertical suspension, and you see, and you, as the rider, you feel a lot of up and down movement as my hips are lifting and dropping as her back does. So the trot is is also a diagonal gate, a two-beat diagonal gate. So two beats means that the feet hit the ground in pairs, and diagonal means opposite corners. So you see that her left hind, or outside hind in this case, hits the ground the same time as the inside four, and vice versa. Inside hind, outside four hit the ground at the same time. So her feet are hitting the ground in diagonal pairs. So because the trot has a lot of vertical motion, a lot of lift, a lot of suspension, it's a little bit harder to ride. So we can either ride the trot sitting, but realize there is lateral movement in the hips of the horse at the trot. So let me come around and I'll ride directly away from you. And so that same side to side, one, two, right, left, feeling that you had at the walk is also present at the trot. So the way that we ride the trot is either posting, sitting, or standing. And we are always riding in the one, two rhythm. We're having to lift up with the horse as he moves at the trot. Again, even though there's a lateral right-left movement in my lower body, I do not want that movement to come into my upper body at all. So I want my lower legs to be, you know, softly wrapped around the barrel of the horse, moving with the horse, but not my upper body, so just my lower body. Okay, so we'll let one of us catch our breath for just a second, and then we'll talk about the footfalls of the canter and the rhythm that you feel as a rider. So we'll let Annie, this is my little horse Annie, by the way. She's my only mare, the only mare we have around here. Sweet, sweet little horse. She's a finished bridle horse, also a bridle-less horse. And I spend most of my time riding my young horse because he needs the most training. But I sure am grateful to have a nice horse like this to ride whenever I need her. And it's been a few weeks since I've been on her, and I've forgotten what a nice ride she is. And so I just want to give her a minute to catch her breath and clear her airway. And you heard her sneezing a minute ago. It's a little bit dusty in here. And so next we want to talk about footfalls of the canter and the rhythms that you feel in the saddle to ride the canter fluidly and in rhythm with the horse, with your bottom glued to the saddle, is something that comes later in riding. It's you know, sort of the beginning of riding, I should say. It's the beginning of advanced riding. It's when you really learn to sit that canter well and glue your bottom to the seat and cue the horse for the proper lead and lead changes and all of that. So the footfalls of the canter are complicated. And in fact, everything about the canter, the way you ride it, the cue, and the footfalls is complicated. It's the most complicated of gaits. And one reason is that the horse changes the pattern of footfall when he changes direction. In other words, when you ask that horse to trot, and he trots right, left, right, left, right, left, no matter which way you go, turn this way, that way, circle, serpentine, whatever, he's still going right, left, right, left, right, left. But when we canter, the horse is on leads. And when he goes to the left, he's on the left lead. And when he turns and goes to the right, He has to reorganize his footfalls into the other lead. And so changing directions is complicated at the canter. Leads are complicated. The canter is in fact a three-beat gait, and that right there makes it complicated because he has four legs and it's a three-beat gait. So the pattern of footfalls of the canter, it would behoove you to memorize this and really ingrain it into your knowledge base, because it has so much to do with the way in which the horse moves at the canter. But the stride begins with the outside hind leg. So if I'm going to the left, that means the stride begins with the right hind leg. So that's beat number one in the three-beat rhythm. Beat number two is the inside diagonal pair. So if I'm going to the left, that's going to be the inside hind and the outside four. They're going to hit the ground at the exact same moment. And then the third and final beat of the canter is the inside or leading foreleg, which in this case, going to the left, will be the left foreleg. There's a moment when her entire body weight rolls over that one inside foreleg as she brings both hind legs up underneath her and comes into a moment of suspension, and then the whole stride begins again. Outside hind, inside diagonal pair, leading foreleg, suspension. And so let's just first take a look at that much of it. So what I want you to focus on is all 4 feet of the horse, and in particular, watch for the 2 feet hitting the ground at the same time, which is going to be the left hind leg and the right foreleg. I want you to just watch those 2 feet. And in noticing those 2 feet hitting the ground at the same time, you'll also see that outside hind leg comes a little bit first. You'll see the leading leg come last, and then the horse rolling over in her stride in the moment of suspension. All right, so in seeing the footfalls then, hopefully you also saw that she was on the left lead. And that means that her left foreleg and her left hind leg are both reaching farther forward than the right legs, and she's picking them up higher. And so what's important to know there is that she has a hind lead and a front lead, and they have to be the same for the horse to be on the correct lead. Remember, movement always comes from behind in the horse, so it's really the hind leg that matters the most. And so to say that she's on the correct lead, we need to make sure that both her left hind and her left fore are reaching farther forward than the right legs, and she's picking them up higher. Therefore, what I feel as the rider from the horse's back, when I am in a balanced position, perfectly vertical, with my belly button tucked in, my tailbone tucked under, my weight stretching down my backside into my heels, and being very centered and tall, the marionette string, if I'm very centered and balanced on my horse, and she is on the left lead, and she's picking both her left feet up higher, I will feel crookedness in the saddle like this. If she is also reaching farther forward with her left feet, I'm going to feel crookedness in the saddle like this. So I will actually feel my left leg and hip in front of my right leg and hip. I'll feel more weight in my right stirrup because her back is crooked like this, and my left leg will be in front of my right leg because her back is crooked like this. So that's two ways in which I can feel which lead the horse is on.
Also, this is my correct leg position anyway, because I need my inside leg to be slightly forward and energized to keep the horse from dropping the shoulder when I turn her. And my outside leg is holding the horse's hip to the inside as it should be as she comes around the turn. So watch one more time, and then this time I want you to focus on the lead, and she's gonna be on the left lead, and notice the feet coming higher and the feet coming forward. And notice how far back I'm sitting, and that the rhythm of the rider in the canter or lope is that your hips make a circle and that there is a moment in the stride when my shoulders actually go behind my hips. So let's take a look at that one more time. I just asked her, she was getting tired of being on one lead, so I asked her to change directions and change to the right lead. And then you saw an entire reversal of the footfalls again, and which are the leading legs. So that is your lesson on footfalls and how you ride in rhythm with your horse in all three gaits. Remember, the natural gaits of the horse are walk, trot, and gallop. Canter or lope is a slow collected gallop, and that's a gait we train into the horse. It's not really a natural gait. Going faster at the gallop is more up their alley. If you ride a gaited horse, that means that through breeding and genetics, that the natural gaits of the horse, walk, trot, and gallop, have been genetically altered for the horse to move in a way that generally removes all the suspension from the gaits. So they no longer trot and they no longer canter. They have the rhythms of the footfalls are different with different gaits and different breeds of gaited horses. But there's a rhythm there, there's a footfall, you should know it. And there's a way in which that gait moves your body. And that's an important part of riding in rhythm with your horse and being centered and balanced on the horse. It's also an important part of cueing the horse, how your body moves in that gait. So that's your daily dose of horsemanship homework for today. If you are at home with your horse, you get to run out and try to feel all these rhythms on your horse and correlate what you understand to be the footfalls of the horse. If you are at home, I want you to answer this question for me. What are the rhythms of the walk, trot, and canter? How many beats are in the gaits? Number one. Number two, what did you learn from this lesson? One thing that you learned about cantering. So that's your daily dose of horsemanship homework for today. Thanks for joining me. I'm Julie Goodnight. You can find out much, much more about riding and horses at juliegoodnight.com. Thanks for joining me.